evening. I'm Keanu Lush.
I'm Kim Webby.
Hey, welcome to Newsnight. Coming up, Cindy waits for no man but makes an exception for passion action man Billy Baldwin.
Hamilton becomes the haven of the hog as a new breed rolls into town.
And not lifestyles, but the food of the rich and famous. A taste of food TV comes down under. First, though, Al Kim and the news.
The aftermath of a high-altitude avalanche. The Dunedin climbers tonight holed up in hospital after being swept 400 metres down Mount Aspiring. The man and his companion were saved after a passing plane spotted their help sign scraped in the snow. John McDermott has more.
Mount Aspiring today at its majestic best. But high up in the snow, a plea for help. It was written there last evening by a Dunedin surgeon. He had just seen his climbing companion swept 400 metres in an avalanche and thought he was dead.
He's walking along in front of his mate, about, I suppose, 20 feet in front of him, and just the top layer of snow just let go, and away he went over the side.
The notoriously dangerous area is known as the Ramp and has already claimed several lives.
He's very lucky man. He'd broken both his legs. He was in a fair bit of pain when we picked him up. But I think he's pretty happy to see us.
Experienced climbers, the pair were well equipped. But they'd have been in real trouble if a tourist pilot hadn't spotted them. The drama carries a warning for other climbers.
Obviously when spring conditions are there, there's probably more chance of avalanches.
Other climbers shouldn't count on being so lucky.
A 27-year-old man has given himself up to Christchurch police tonight. The development comes after an unusual robbery at a Sumner bank yesterday in which a man used a blood-filled syringe to threaten bank staff. Police say the 27-year-old will face charges at Christchurch District Court tomorrow. Overseas and tears in Israel at the funeral of assassinated Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin. The presidents, prime ministers and monarchs of 80 countries were there to see him buried, with prayers for peace and fears for the future. This from Channel 9.
A remarkable gallery of mourners came to say goodbye to Yitzhak Rabin, former enemies and friends, here to support the cause for peace, which cost his life. His wooden soldier's coffin wrapped in the Star of David, passing his widow Leah to the burial ground of Israel's national heroes. A siren sounded for 2 minutes all across Israel, and nearly all stopped to mourn. Wiping away their tears, they returned to work, but in hardline religious areas, they went about their business without pausing. There was a volley of shots as the service came to a close. A cantor sang, "O Merciful God," as Rabin was lowered into his grave. By nightfall, crowds began filing past Rabin's grave, and Israel announced it was getting on with the job of peace. In the morning, Jewish troops will resume their West Bank withdrawal.
Back home to the royal tour, Sam Brackenhoff had his day to spray today, and spray he did. The fervent anti-royalist with a penchant for deodorising pointed his can of air freshener at the Queen and Prince Philip's car to remove what he calls the stench of royalty. But he didn't get that close. The royal couple sped past for the running of the Queen Elizabeth II stakes at Ellerslie. There was a real stink when a farmer took the unusual revenge on his local bank. But David Cannon's pungent protest has cost him a hefty fine.
The dairy farmer told magistrates that 5 years of frustration led him to attack the bank with his muck spreader. He deliberately drove into Newcastle on a quiet Sunday morning. An amateur cameraman pictured Mr. Cannon spraying the National Westminster building with 4 tons of foul-smelling slurry. The flood of manure blocked the door before police arrested the farmer. The bank manager, Alan Bell, said the slurry on the stonework had to be professionally cleaned. David Cannon told the court that bank mismanagement had forced him to sell his prize-winning dairy herd. And after the conditional discharge, he was unrepentant.
Well, it could have been worse. Considering the way it caught, it could have been worse.
It's the second time the farmer has resorted to muck spreader protest. 3 years ago, he sprayed council officers in Morpeth over a planning dispute and was ordered to pay £1,100 compensation.
Back home, they can get pretty wild on the west coast too. Something big, hairy and scary is frightening the tourists. Brent Fraser with the West Coast Yeti.
Well, it's been around here for many, many years. And it's generally early hours of the morning when it's been seen.
This is what Les Lyle is talking about. It's small, scampers through the undergrowth, and over the years has been reported up and down the west coast. The most recent sighting of the hairy, man-like creature was in this dense bush just last month. It was seen by a 30-year-old German tourist who was heading down to the lake for a midnight swim.
Just stuttering and as white as a ghost and couldn't get the words out for a start.
Her fear alarmed the pub owner.
Said, well, what's happened? Has somebody been drowned or something like that? We've actually chased it, like, you know, before when the bush was here and that, we've chased it through the bush. But it's, you know, just too quick for us.
And its nocturnal pursuits aren't just limited to scaring tourists. The publican says it's also raided vegetables from his garden and whitebait from his freezer.
He's taken everything out of the damn thing except a couple of packets. That's about all that's left.
But Les and his pub worker say they won't be frightened away.
It's going to get you. It's going to get you. Yeah, I don't think you can do, you know, you can't worry too much about it, I suppose. If you're worried about that, you'd be worried about everything, wouldn't you?
Les Lyle says he hopes that unlike the Yeti and Bigfoot, the West Coast's monster will soon be caught.
That's the news. I guess if they catch him, he'll be a real big cheese in that town.
He walked in Mahaneapu with the cheese.
And
they could put him in the new primate enclosure at the Auckland Zoo, couldn't they?
Of course, yes.
With the chimps.
The brand new one with all the, yeah.
The one they won't let me go in and film.
Yeah, that's the one.
We're having trouble with the primate enclosure at the zoo anyway, but that'd be good for
them.
They
could just send all the primates to the west coast as well.
They could and get those ones up here.
Yeah.
Hey, still to come, Hog Heaven in Hamilton. Hamilton. And they love food, and they love TV. Americans come up with the obvious answer, FTV.
Cut up the chicken with this trusty saber.
There it is. Let's go.
The TV Food Network.
News Night. Later on tonight, I'll have the latest showbiz gossip. You know, Anna, Nicole, Pam, Cindy, etc. That's right, paparazzi, the greatest change in format since we moved the weather. All that more, much, much later. In the meantime, here is Kim.
Thanks, Marcus. Move over MTV, another cable channel's capturing American couch potatoes. TVFN, the Food Network. It's a 24-hour channel chock-a-block with food. There's everything from shows on how to boil water, that's what I need, to what the celebs are eating and where. TVFN's head foodie, Sue Huffman, visited Auckland recently. We caught up with her and talked a little turkey.
Why do I have to use meat?
Here I have a little bit of rice and vegetables.
You want to hold it. You want to caress it.
You know, I like to eat.
This is the TV Food Network.
I am probably not the world's neatest cook.
Cut up the chicken with this crusty saber.
There it is.
Let's go.
The TV Food Network.
Reese Schoenfeld is the man who basically started CNN, which is, I know, doesn't need any explanation here in New Zealand what it is. Reese had gone to Ted Turner and said, I've got this great idea for a network. And, you know, eventually they got it rolling.
Robin Leach and his culinary sidekick, Kate Conley, chatted up with big names and famous faces on Talking Food.
Talking Food is a late night talk show. It's the kind of conversation that you would want to have if you retired to the library with a great brandy and a great cigar.
Robin is so excited he's going on the road, which is, we all know, that is where Robin Leach loves to go. In January, he will start going all over the world to wonderful restaurants. I mean, you know, tough duty. And interviewing again the rich and famous, which he's very good at, but more with a food highlight.
Gonna do an okra fritter coming up. Before we do that, let's give a hug. Get on in my arms, and that feels good.
There is this adorable guy, and his name is Sean Donnellan, and he is a comedian, about 25, 26. He is just so very natural, and he came on board, and it was kind of like the viewer was going to learn to cook with Sean. He does a lot of really funky, convenient stuff. You know, they'll play Nerf ball in between and that kind of thing.
And, of course, America's most famous chef, Julia Child, serves up something special every day on Cooking Classics.
The Chicken Sisters! Miss Broiler, Miss Fryer, Miss Roaster, Miss Capernet, Miss Stewart, and old Madam Hemp.
I love TV.
This is kind of
thin for the grill, but you could do it on the grill. Another thing you could do is cut it up into kebabs. And you could do a wonderful marinade of lime juice and olive oil and some hot stuff and maybe a little Thai seasoning if you have. Asparagus. Now, you know this trick, of course, don't you? You always break it up. You don't ever need to cut asparagus. Just wherever it wants to break, that's where you break it. You know, I think these are the working person's salvation, the chicken cutlets. You just brown them very quickly on both sides. One, you make a wonderful sauce with tomatoes, and you can use canned tomatoes or fresh, lemon zest, some balsamic vinegar, and it's really a balsamic vinaigrette is what you're making. Everybody likes carrots, right? We're not cooked. These I would grill, just very simply. All you would need to put on these really would be a wonderful, really good extra virgin olive oil. I think celery only has one use in this world, and that is to stir Bloody Marys. Broccoli is probably one of my favorite vegetables. You can do it with a little sesame oil, sesame seeds, and a little hot chili oil, and it's quite good. So I'm going to plop this in the microwave. I'm going to pierce it with a fork, wet it, wrap a paper towel around it that can go in the mic, stick it on a rack in the mic, and let it, 6 minutes or so. And then I'm going to put low-fat cottage cheese on it and lots of salsa. Where's the wine?
Yum.
What a sicko, coming down here and trying to convince us that broccoli is your favorite vegetable, like as if. Like as if anyone would eat broccoli by chance.
There was a special broccoli sort of thing in the cafeteria tonight. Did you miss that?
No! Oh. I'll tell you, when I was in the cafeteria, we had that tipped-up ice cream machine.
Yeah.
Every night before the show, went up, got a Rocky Road.
Oh.
Got up there tonight, what's there? Fruit juice.
Yeah.
No Rocky Roads went too. My favourite ice snack, gone.
Oh, what a
gone.
Shame.
Wait till I find that loser that's taken our own. Rocky Roads, broccoli.
I'll probably get
what
you
was
some
the broccoli
more.
Thing in the cafe? I missed it.
It was sort of like a quiche thing, I guess, but without a base. You know that.
They forget the base.
I don't know.
Did it taste all right?
I don't know. Stalfa had some. I didn't have
it's any. Amazing they don't do a cooking show up there in the cafe. They could, couldn't they, and
yeah,
broadcast that?
Absolutely.
People would tune in.
Yeah. That looked like a fun one.
Yeah, that'll be a much fun one. We're on this one.
Okay, then.
Yeah.
Well, once they were the symbol of youth and rebellion. Now they're more often middle-of-the-road status symbols for the middle-aged. Harley-Davidsons have found a whole new fan club among well-paid leisure riders. I checked out 8 of the latest hogs on display in Hamilton.
They're not what you'd call the fastest bike on the road, but it's the fastest way to relieve some stress, and I can tell you it's just awesome to jump on your Harley after a hard day's work and go out and have some fun.
It was hog heaven in Hamilton last week when 8 of the latest Harleys were on show direct from Milwaukee.
The engineering has come a long way since the old days, so the picture of an old Harley Davidson with the oil leaking below it is gone forever. Very reliable. Very well engineered machine. Quality control is excellent.
What is it about Harleys that people love? What is that Harley mystique?
Well, Harleys make a very mysterious sound, very unique. There's only one bike that sounds like a Harley. The noise itself, you know, the feel of freedom that you get riding your Harley.
A brand new bike costs between $14,000 and
$35,000. They're pricey. Are they a bit of a new yuppie status symbol?
It's very much, with some customers, it's a status symbol. I think when you're buying expensive machinery, you need to have a reasonable amount of ego to go with it. But that's only a part of the whole reason why people buy Harleys. I can't explain it all. It's really mysterious.
And while sales of most motorbikes have slumped, Harley holds its own.
Who's riding them?
People like yourself, people that are in perhaps executive positions, people that have worked hard and that's all they wanted to save up for, people that have had their children grow up and now mum and dad want to try and find a bit of freedom together.
Hey, coming up, the subliminal side to Chogham. That's right, Chogham, we finally get to mention it. And passing action with supermodel Cinders, Billy Baldwin tells all.
We kind of started kissing and we kind of stopped for a moment and we backed away from each other and I just looked into her eyes and she looked into my eyes and we both looked at each other like, wow, can you believe this?
Get your pen and paper ready for today's official daily...
In hardware or is it more software?
Hardware. I was hoping to demo your unit.
For most of the film, Cinders is running away from the bad guys, but she also gets a chance for a quick bit of How's Your Father with one of those Baldwin boys.
The first kiss was actually very, very sweet and very touching in a way because we were a little bit uncomfortable, you know, because we had never kissed before. And it tied in well to the characters because they had never kissed before. And when we kissed, we kind of started kissing and we kind of stopped for a moment and we backed away from each other. And I just looked into her eyes and she looked into my eyes and we both looked at each other like, wow, can you believe this?
It's like, screw you, screw you, screw me.
Gosh. Meanwhile, Pamela's refusing to comment on claims that she's been experimenting with revolutionary new breast reduction techniques. Here's Hugh. As you do, there you go. Anyway, now tonight's information kiosk. Newsnight headquarters was delighted today to see that the motorcade security loop for the Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting was pretty much the shape of a vodka bottle. There you go, this is me. We wonder if any enterprising young whippersnappers in advertising will pick up on it. If so, I wouldn't mind a job. Leave a message with Mum. And I'm not the only one to be seeing meaningful things in maps. Courtney Love's just endeared herself to the state of Florida by describing it as so violent, even the shape of the state is a handgun. Gosh! See, there you go. Love was led off a case there today where she'd been accused of punching two fans when she leapt into a crowd during the performance. The judge said the two teenage boys had nothing to complain about, but the biff and rough and tumble is just what you expect at a rock concert. Fair enough. Still, Love was not won over and said afterwards that Florida was just not a rock and roll friendly state. And we may have the Sky Tower well on its way, but in Johannesburg it seems a Lego skyscraper is just the ticket. The kids there have just finished building the world's tallest tower made from the plastic blocks. There you go, it's 23 metres tall and was done for charity. The tallest one before the South African takeover was in Poland, which just goes to show that weird towers are springing up everywhere. And email of the week, some shows have a fax of the week, we have an email of the week. Here it is. I'll read it here now. It's about the horse boy. I'll read it to you. Hello, News 90s. Here is a poem I have written about horse boy. Horse boy is more than a toy. He fills the screen with love and joy. He's more than a head on a pole. He fills up television's empty hole. I would like to take horse boy for a spin. Lots of fun would soon begin. We could gallop down the street. I think that would be really neat. I like horse boy's fuzzy blue face. He travels at a moderate pace. Horse boy is a very nice thing. A good use of old bits of string. Horseboy's friend has got a mohawk. That must make the neighbours talk. Now that Horseboy has a friend, it seems the fun will never end. Oh, I'm glad that there are others who think Horseboy rocks as much as I think I do, Herman Aphrodite. So it just goes to show that the internet's not full of boffins, and that was a very good poem. And where am I now? I was excited about the poem. Yeah, what camera, though? That's tonight. That's tonight's Up Your Jumper. Here's Kim with tomorrow's weather.
Thanks, Marcus. Well, there's no need for a jumper tomorrow because the temperatures are heating up. Sun's out in the north with clear blue skies, just a little cloud in a couple of places. Top temperature hits 22 in sunny Kaitaia, while New Plymouth and the capital clock in on 17. Across the strait, the rain moves in with a few clouds down the west coast. Still reaching some warm temperatures, Blenheim reaches 21.
Great weather tomorrow.
Fantastic.
Hey, tomorrow's show, we couldn't talk to them tonight because the flight was delayed, then the press conference took to weather, but boy will we have them tomorrow. Bon Jovi.
what Debbie Singh would make of them.
Who?
Debbie Singh.
Oh, she did that thing on that. Yeah, because it's men stereotypes and rock clips and stuff
like
that.
That's right, the study, the university study. It's very serious.
Apparently the tickets haven't sold out for that concert with Bon Jovi. I saw that on the news.
But Kiwis always go, they just turn up at the gate late, don't they?
I feel
they
funny.
Like to do that.
I feel funny come saying I saw that on the news, because some people would say that about us, wouldn't they? I saw that on the news. Because we're the news.
Yes.
Yeah.
The alternative news. Anyway, we'll be chatting to them. That's Bon Jovi and their support band, Keanu's power pop trio, Dogstar.
Rock star. I don't know. I'd like to be in a band that that makes good music, and the music that I enjoy, and hopefully music that other people will enjoy. It's good fun to play, and it's when you get the chance to play, it's extraordinary. You know, you hang out with friends, you get free beer, you travel, and you get to, you know, you get to play.
There's another career option.
Yeah.
Good night.
Good night. Bye-bye.